morning, friends.
Good morning. Good morning.
Our opening scripture is Mark 1:8. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. If you will take a couple of quick moments, and we'll look at the back of the bulletin for some announcements. It feels like forever since we've done announcements, doesn't it? So you will notice that we have a congregational meeting on the 24th. This is just our annual meeting to go over the year's events. We will be looking at a couple of bylaw shifts just to kind of handle changes that have been presented over the last year or so. Also, giving envelopes will be available next Sunday. We had some printing delays on those. And also, we do have a few of Christmas ornaments left if anybody would like one. We have just about 5% left, which is really kind of amazing considering the number of Christmas ornaments that went out. Are there any other announcements that you need to share this morning? Having seen none, let's continue on in worship by joining together in the call to worship. The voice of the Lord is over the sea.
The glory thunders.
The voice of the Lord flashes forth with flame.
It shakes the wilderness and causes the oaks to whirl.
The voice of the Lord strips the forest bare.
And all in God's temple say, Glory.
Worship the Lord in holy splendor. Together let us worship our God. Let us join together in prayer. Holy One, we gather this day to worship you, to acknowledge your glory and your strength. Quiet the other voices that clamor for our attention as we strive to hear your voice, to hear your call, to hear you claiming us as your people, both in our baptism as well as in the years after. For your voice is mighty and it sounds throughout our world. Call to faithfulness, to justice, and to mercy. Amen. I see our little ones are getting more and more agile all the time. You know, I love seeing every last one of you, but I really love seeing our little ones because, you know, they change so much in a couple of months, don't they? And you know, what was just this big a little while ago can get inches and inches bigger and so much more personality. So it's such a joy to have everyone together again, but certainly our little ones are a special joy. As we think about the calling of God to be his people, we hear in Scripture, and Scripture encourages us to consider how it is that we are pleasing to God. And also with it, perhaps displeasing God. So acknowledging both sides of our personalities, of our choices, and our life, let us join together in honest confession, reading together. Gracious and loving God, we confess that our motives are not pure. We desire to please others and forget to focus on pleasing you. We look for their praise instead of yours. We get caught in wanting to be liked and wanting to be admired and forget about wanting to be grateful. Forgive us, O Lord. Forgive us and give us the courage to do and say what here proclaim the good news of the gospel.
In Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
And as we hear that we are forgiven, so too let us remember that our brothers and sisters in Christ are also forgiven. Let us not hold or harbor any ill will between ourselves, but rather see each other as grace-filled children of God. With that in mind, the peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
I encourage you to stand and to pass the peace at a distance. Of all light, by your word, you give light to our soul. Pour out on us the spirit of wisdom and understanding, that our hearts and minds might be open. Amen. Our first reading, so fitting for the beginning of the year, is Genesis 1, verses 1 through 5. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was formless, void, and covered the face of the deep. While a wind from God swept over the face of the waters, then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness, and God
They replied, we've not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit. Then he said, what baptism did you receive then? They answered, John's baptism. Paul explained, John baptized with a baptism by which people showed they were changing their hearts and lives. It was a baptism that told people about the one who was coming after him. This is the one in whom they were to believe. This one is Jesus. After they listened to Paul, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. When Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they began speaking in other languages and prophesying. Altogether, there were about 12 people. That is one of the first witnesses of what baptism is about. Then we turn to the Gospel of Mark in the first chapter. John, who we know as John the Baptist, was in the wilderness calling for people to be baptized to show that they were changing their hearts and lives and wanting God to forgive their sins. Everyone in Judea and all the people of Jerusalem went out to the Jordan River and were being baptized by John as they confessed their sins. John wore clothes made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. He ate locusts and wild honey because he was known as a Nazarene. He announced, "One stronger than I is coming after me. I'm not even worthy to bend over and loosen the strap of his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." About that time, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and John baptized him in the river Jordan. While he was coming up out of the water, Jesus saw heaven splitting open and the Spirit like a dove coming down on him. And there was a voice from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I dearly love. In you I find happiness." Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Would you pray with me? Still speaking, God, eternal Spirit of the universe, we thank you that you do not leave us alone, but place your word within us in the midst of our life together. Your Spirit is a living reality on the face of the earth and in our lives. Give us the courage and commitment to receive your Spirit to care for the needs of all people in a fellowship that prays you day by day. Grant us your peace with confidence, hope, and thanksgiving for gifts and graces that bless us to bless one another. This we pray in the name of Jesus the Christ, our Savior. And now the new year has begun with much hope and expectancy of what some would call that we need to get back to normalcy, which I don't think we will ever return to. January 6th was Epiphany, the visit of the wise men almost 2 years after Jesus' birth, and now we travel a journey with Jesus that changed him from a baby now to a grown human man. I have friends who send cards with letters that arrive after the celebration of Christ's birth, stating they were just wanting to truly send a Christmas card. Now, some psychologists and some psychiatrists can analyze the weight and find some deeper, unresolved, mysterious, skeptical, well, you name it, reason for waiting. Yet Christmas should be a year-long, everyday celebration of peace and goodwill to all. Love and compassion in action, kindness and generosity in gratefulness to God. It was the lectionary for today that jolted me and reminded me that we are beyond the baby Jesus, or at least we are supposed to be. The words for today from Mark's Gospel are about baptism, and we are jolted that Jesus is no longer a baby. Just in 2 weeks, think about that. He is now 30 years old. Quite an accomplishment in 2 weeks. Birth and baptism are actions of God's creativity and grace. Sycamore Church, as your pastor talks about, announces a birth, I'm sure, and gives thanks to God for the precious gift given to parents and our Christian family. In our tradition, holy baptism comes shortly after the birth of a child. The child is brought to the church, and we recognize God's gift and God's grace in our midst through covenants, through the promises that are made on the day of baptism. In our baptismal service, there is a point of the service that the pastor asks the parents, what is the name given the child? Symbolically, even though the child's name is known, printed in the bulletin, and mentioned before the baptism, the child comes before the congregation and God without identity, but upon baptism is given an unique identity. Parents give their children names that will connect children to the ongoing family history that is shared from generation to generation. Children will also become ancestors, for future family members will have relationship to that child. Some people may never have biological children, but will be connected to others who come into their family as well as into the church family. There is a song that asks Mary, what you gonna name that tiny little baby born in Bethlehem? What is the name given to each one of us? Why did our parents give us a certain name? Many of us have been told often about stories of our families and friends about names, and the oral traditions are passed from one generation to another. When my mother's family would get together, so many stories would be told about the good old days, and my mother, Lydia, was the matriarch of the family, and she was the authority on family history, and we would sit around listening to her family stories that she shared with us. When we would get together before the birth of another cousin and before ultra In certain traditions or religious communities or socioeconomic groups, names are given to continue identities. We also attach nicknames to our friends that become their names for life. At my high school graduation, we all learned what each other's real name was. Some names were such an embarrassment, their real names, that some students tried to get the high school administration to keep them a secret. Names do carry with them identities. We are given names with the hopes and dreams of a great future before us, and reflection of a connectedness to a family, to a community, and to a faith community. In Genesis, which was read this morning from the first chapter, we read about God's creating something out of nothing. We might think our lives are not worth much, but God creates us with possibilities to become something vital. The creation story from Genesis 1 reminds us how God creates an amazing world and beings when the earth was without shape or form. It was dark over the deep seas. God creates order, form, and substance out of what seems like nothingness and disorder. God does create something new and renews what exists, including each one of us. Mysteriously, our lives are wonderful creations of God, never before imagined by anyone and never again to be duplicated. We come into Christ's presence with our needs, especially the need for God's grace and forgiveness. We may go away looking very much the same, but we are filled with Christ's love. Think about that. In our covenant with God and with one another, we are included in the Christian family. As Luke tells us, in simple elements of water, the heavens open up. So, come, be open to God's voice, ready for the heavens to be torn apart. For God declares to you, to all of us, to this world, you, each one of you, all of us, are God's sons, God's daughters. You are God's daughter. You are God's son, whom I dearly love. In you I find happiness. O God, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart, be holy and acceptable to you, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. There's an insert this morning. I want you to notice what the words say at the top. It says, renewal of baptismal vows. You are not being rebaptized. This is important this morning, because in our tradition, baptism happens once. Whether as a baby, or as an adult. God's grace is upon us at the time of baptism. God is with us always. I've asked Matthew to help me, or we're sharing this together, so come on down. Personalities. And at the time, for those who would like, you are asked to come, will be asked.
still to see the storming of one of our places of politics and discussion is a day I wish I never would have come to. I remember very well in my first year of ministry watching 9/11 and thinking to myself, I hope I never have another one of those moments in my life. In some ways, friends, I think this is another one of those. That sort of behavior shows that we are in desperate need of coming together as one family and to see each other as brothers and sisters and co-heirs with Christ. That's not to say one side or another of red or blue, depending on whichever you are and whichever you vote, but that this is not the way we behave as a family. So I know that that's probably weighing upon many of our hearts and minds, especially as we look forward to a new administration in the weeks to come. So wherever you are in your own beliefs and practices, may I encourage you, maybe first, let's pray for you. Let's pray for civil discourse. Let's pray for treating each other as our neighbors, as we have been instructed by followers of Christ. Are there other prayer concerns or praise you'd like to share with the congregation this morning? Yes, Sarah.
This is a joy. On Zoom for the kids, Sunday school class, talk about King Solomon and how God asked Solomon, what is it that you want? I will give you whatever you want. And I asked the kids if God asked you, what would you want? And they all went around, and I just wanted to share the answers with you. We did have somebody else who asked for wisdom, like King Solomon. We had two people who asked for love, one who asked for peace, and one who asked for baby cakes. And I think, you know, if we could all just take the answers of our children, I think all of those things would make the world a better place. So I would appreciate that.
I think the world definitely needs more wisdom, love, peace, and dignity. Yes, sir.
Pastor, I pray for our teachers of our children, that they may take the time and the patience to help younger people understand what has happened to us as a family of Christ in this terrible.
I will echo along with that for teachers and administrators and those in school that in many of our communities this week they'll be trying to return to in-person education. So prayers also with that process with a very turbulent time. I'm going to share one more personal joy. I shared over 8 months ago that my brother was laid off from upper management in the downsizing of Corona and everything. And we were celebrating this week that he found a new position after 8 months of searching. And it certainly takes a weight off the family. So thank you for all your prayers. with our fervent hope that you would bless us and be with us, with our community and with our world. Be in presence that we might sense you and the difference that you make in our choices and in our priorities. We offer you our praise, O God, for you alone are our holy and worthy to be praised. We rejoice in you and give you our thanks for this church that nourishes the faith, for opportunities to work and to learn, to serve and to help others. We are grateful, Lord. We are grateful for the words of wisdom from our children shared to us this day. And we are thankful for the possibilities of new work and new positions. And we are thankful for teachers and educators who work their best to care and educate our children. And Holy God, as the divine light, you are in the midst of all darkness. We pray for those who find it hard to hope, and for difficult to see goodness within their current situation. From those who suffer from depression, from those who are dealing with sadness, for those who have made life choices that leave them full of regret or shame, for those who struggle to find meaningful work or life-giving relationships, bring light, Lord, into their darkness. Be their hope and guide them towards your radiance, that they may know your goodness. Lift up their eyes to see your grace. Our prayers are with those who grieve the loss of a loved one throughout this holiday season, and for those who face the new year with loneliness and a sense of loss. Surround all of these families with your presence, that they may know that they are never alone. Allow good memories of the one they cherished to comfort them and to bring them a measure of peace. Holy God, divine light that brightens the shadows and warms us from the inside out, we pray for those who are sick and struggling with health challenges. We pray especially for those who are continually savaged by the pandemic, as we have crossed yet another milestone for our nation and for our world. We ask that you bring light, bring wholeness, bring healing to each situation, Lord, and remind them that you are there always. You are always here for us to turn to reach to cling to, especially when life gets hard. Holy God, divine light of our world, we pray for our world and for our community, that your justice would reign, that your peace would prevail, and that you might illuminate in us the love of neighbor as ourselves. Holy God, divine light, shine down. Guide us toward you, that we might approach you with joy, offer you what we have to give, and be assured of